Friends, I invite you to join me now for a moment of prayer. Most gracious, most loving God, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for waking us this morning, calling us to gather here as this people of faith. We give you thanks for your love that is always here with us. We ask that you would open us, open our eyes, our ears, our hearts, our minds, that we might be filled with your unconditional love, that as we leave this place, we might share that love, pouring it out everywhere that we go. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's the first Sunday of Advent. We're preparing for Christmas. We're preparing for this amazing birth to happen, for the birth of Jesus, the one whom we call the Christ, our Savior, our Lord, our Redeemer. And what better way to start that preparation than this text, right? This text that is often understood to be talking about the end times. This is when the world is going to end and Jesus is going to come back, is what a lot of people think about it. That's how they interpret it when it says that the Son of Man is going to be coming. The earth is going to be shaking. Everybody is going to be in distress from all this confusion, from all these hardships that they're experiencing. Totally makes sense for the first Sunday of Advent, right? Maybe not. Maybe you're like, what in the world? That's how I am, okay? I'm like, what in the world? Why would we be talking about this time of destruction? We're supposed to be talking about hope. We lit this candle today because Jesus is the hope for the world. But we don't hear a lot of hope here in this text. When I sit down and study with that Thursday evening group, we've been studying the Bible, we're reading through Scripture. We are now into 1 Samuel. So that means we've made it through Joshua and Judges, Ruth, and now we've just started into 1 Samuel. I think today is our first day of 1 Samuel, actually. And oftentimes when we gather, what we've read has had a lot of destruction. Has had a lot of war, has had a lot of battling and slaughtering of people and burning of towns. The scriptures will say that the Lord gave these people over to the Israelites and they slaughtered all of them. And the group of wonderful women who gathered there with me, they kind of scratched their head and they said, Jessica, what kind of God is this? This God doesn't jive with that God of love that you talk with us about. And I remind them that we cannot take this text out of its context, out of the world in which it came to be, out of the world in which it was composed. I read something recently that made a lot of sense. Right, when we read an article, perhaps from 2013, we think, okay, what was going on during that time? When we would maybe read an article from some time in the past, or we read a book, we think about what was happening in history during that time. But for some reason, when we take this Bible of ours, we think of it in a different way, like, oh, this is speaking to us right now. This is happening right now. And we remove it from its context. We remove it from the history in which it was composed. And that's, it makes it kind of hard when you're seeing God slaughtering these people, because God is the one who's in charge in these texts. I have the same problem here in this text. Often folks will take this scripture out from the Gospel of Luke or the Gospel of Mark, where Luke probably got this story, got most of this stuff. And to say, this is speaking to us right now. I don't know if any of you have heard people who've been talking about all of the stuff that's going on in the world now, where we're talking about all these wars, all of this fighting, all of this hardship that people in this world are experiencing today, and they're saying, this is the end times. This is what Jesus was talking about. Okay, well, I want to ground us a little bit. Number one, I don't think Jesus probably actually said these things. That might be shocking for some of you. And that's okay, because this is what I think. If you think differently, you are free to do that. It just doesn't jive with the rest of Jesus' stuff. Jesus was not an apocalyptic guy. He didn't talk about this destruction for this age to come. Also, there's that whole piece about saying, all this is going to happen before you all die. According to my calendar, we're about 2,000 years late. Not quite. It hasn't happened yet. So what is going on? What was going on in the life of these people? Well, the Gospel of Mark, from which Luke borrows his stuff, is thought to have been composed, brought together in 70 CE, or 70 after the, or AD if you do that kind of timing. The Common Era, the year 70. It's a long time ago. But what was going on in Galilee, in Jerusalem, during that time? Well, the poor were being oppressed, and they were starting to rise up. There were revolts that were happening during this time. And there was war with Rome, with the Roman Empire, who had this area. This was under their control. But these people were rising up. They were battling against each other. There was civil war, and there was war with the imperial power. So this distress, this destruction, this was everyday, this was real life. This was not something yet to come. This was right here, what we're living in, what they were living in. So when I read this text, rather than hearing it as, well, when all of this horrible stuff starts happening, then you'll know God's kingdom is near, I hear it in a different way. I hear it as, all of this horrible stuff is going on around you right now. And God is with you. God is going to offer you redemption, just as God always had. God is going to keep God's promises. It's a little different. Rather than waiting for wars to break out, for the earth to shake, for the stars to begin to fall, to realize the stars are falling right now. The earth is shaking right now. The world is in an upheaval. But God is going to be with you through all of this. God is with you even now. So to me, that offers good news to that community, to those people whom the writer of Mark and the writer of Luke were speaking to. But then I have to stop and think, okay, well, how does that actually affect me? Because I don't live in 70, 80, 90 CE. I live in 2015. And I have never experienced anything close to that. I have never experienced civil war. I have never experienced bombs being dropped on my home. I have never actually feared for my life, for my safety and my security. I'm a white, middle-class American. I don't have those concerns. But if you think about it, about the Civil War that was happening for those folks, and the war with folks from outside, a different sort of war going on, this bigger war happening as well, there is a people that comes to my mind. Anybody here heard about what's going on in Syria recently? There's civil war happening there. There's international war happening there. And people are experiencing great unrest and distress. Fear for their lives. Fear for their security. It's actually threatened. I'm a Christian living in the U.S. and they serve my coffee or my latte in a red cup at Starbucks. I am not persecuted. These folks, their safety, their well-being, their world is shaken. Might speak a word of hope to them. But like I said, I'm not them, so what does it have to say to me? How does it actually connect with my life here in Newton, Iowa? Well, as a follower of Jesus, as a member of the body of Christ, you know, we are called to be the body of Christ. We are called to follow in the ways of Jesus, the ways that welcome the stranger, the ways that clothe the naked, the ways that give the thirsty something to drink, that free the oppressed, that offer relief to all those in distress. I think, I am called to be a part of bringing that redemption, to being a part of bringing, offering some safety, some security, some peace to those who are experiencing this horrific destruction, this great distress. Toward the end of this text, you know, the folks are called to maintain the faith, to keep following Jesus, to keep being good disciples, living out Jesus' ways in their lives. Not to be caught up in drunkenness and all that good stuff, continue to trust in the ways of God. To actually live these things out. How might I do that? How might I welcome the stranger? How might I offer comfort to the afflicted? How might I offer clothing to the naked, food to the hungry, water to the thirsty? I do not believe this text is about the end of days, when all the world is going to come to an end. But I do believe our redemption is near. The kingdom of God is so close to us. It is coming. I see that when a group of 25 or 30 clergy gather at the state capitol and call on our governor and other leaders in this nation to welcome people who are fleeing the Islamic State and the destruction of their country. People of faith who are trusting in the ways of God above fear. That is a sign of hope. That is a sign that God's realm is close at hand. As I spoke with the children, hope is way more than a wish. You can wish for world peace. You can wish for all kinds of things. Oh, I really love that this would happen, but it may or may not. Friends, as followers of Jesus, we are called hope. We are called to trust in God's promises for us and for this entire world. To trust that God's love will win out in the end. And to live as if that is actually true, rather than living out of fear. Friends, there are people all over this world whose worlds are shaking, whose skies are falling. How will you point to that hope? How will you be a bearer of hope in this world, in those circumstances, in those times of distress and destruction? Where will you find that hope is found? Friends, I invite you to join now in singing hymn 119. Come, O come, Emmanuel.